This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The armored cruiser was a type of warship of the late 19th and early 20th centuries. It was designed like other types of cruisers to operate as a long-range, independent warship, capable of defeating any ship apart from a battleship and fast enough to outrun any battleship it encountered, varying in size. It was distinguished from other types of cruiser by its belt armor, thick iron or later steel plating on much of the hull to protect the ship from shellfire, much like that on battleships. The first armored cruiser, the Imperial Russian Navy's General-Admiral, was launched in 1873 and combined sail and steam propulsion. By the 1890s, cruisers had abandoned sail and took on a modern appearance. For many decades, naval technology had not advanced far enough for designers to produce a cruiser which combined an armored belt with the long range and high speed required to fulfill its mission. For this reason, many navies preferred to build protected cruisers. In the 1880s and early 1890s, it was often possible to build cruisers which were faster and better all round using this type of ship, which relied on a lighter armored deck to protect the vital parts of the ship. However, by the late 1880s, the development of rapid-fire cannon and high-explosive shells made the reintroduction of side armor a necessity. The invention of face-hardened armor in the mid-1890s offered effective protection with less weight than previously. In 1908, the armored cruiser was supplanted by the battlecruiser, which, with armament equivalent to that of a dreadnought battleship and steam turbine engines, was faster and more powerful than armored cruisers. At around the same time, the term light cruiser came into use for small cruisers with armored belts, despite the fact they were now considered second-class ships. Armored cruisers were widely used in World War I. Most surviving armored cruisers from this conflict were scrapped under the terms of the Washington Naval Treaty of 1922, which imposed limits on warships and defined a cruiser as a ship of 10,000 tons or less, carrying guns of 8-inch caliber or less, rather smaller than many of the large armored cruisers. A handful survived in one form or another until World War II. Contents 1. Background: armor, guns and engines. 2. 1870s, first armored cruisers. 3. 1880s, rise of the protected cruiser. 4. 1890s, armored cruisers in the pre-dreadnought era. 5. 1900s, Battle of Tsushima and the battlecruiser. 6. World War I. 7. Post-World War I, Panzerschiff and End. 8. Differences between armored cruisers and heavy cruisers. 9. See also 10. References. 11. Bibliography. 12. External links. Background: armor, guns and engines. HMS cannon, which were readopted into naval use in the 1870s, were more destructive than muzzle loaders due to their higher rate of fire. The development of rifled cannon, which improved accuracy, and advancements in shells were other factors. Although a cruiser would not likely face the largest caliber guns of a battleship, and many navies commonly used smaller weapons as they did not wear out as fast as larger ones did, cruisers still needed some form of protection to preclude being shot to pieces. The wrought iron and wood armor of HMS especially had hoped to rely on these vessels to serve the more distant reaches of its empire in the aftermath of the Battle of Hampton Roads in 1862, where United States wooden warships were defeated by the Confederate ironclad CSS. The Russian Navy became the first to produce an armored warship intended for commerce raiding, with the General Admiral, begun in 1870 and launched in 1873, often referred to as the first armored cruiser, armed with 6 8-inch 203. 3-inch 76. Large degree of stability. The use of armored turrets as used on monitors and some battleships was ruled out, because a turret was a very heavy weight high in the ship and its placement necessitated a lower freeboard than was warranted for an ocean-going vessel. The loss of HMS Captain in 1870 with nearly all of her 500-man crew illustrated graphically what could happen in a heavy sea with a turret-equipped steam and sail vessel. Consequently, armored cruisers retained a more traditional broadside arrangement. Their armor was distributed in a thick belt around the waterline along most of their length. The gun positions on deck were not necessarily armored at all. The limitations of these ships would not be rectified fully until decades after their construction. Meanwhile, a battle in May 1877 between the British unarmored cruiser Shaw and the Peruvian monitor Huascar demonstrated the need for more and better protected cruisers. Shaw and the smaller wooden corvette Amethyst hit Huascar more than 50 times without causing significant damage. The Peruvian ship had an inexperienced crew unused to its cumbersome machinery, and managed to fire only 6 rounds, all of which missed. The engagement demonstrated the value of cruisers with armor protection. 1880s, rise of the protected cruiser. Schematic of a protected cruiser. Red lines, armored deck and gun shield. Gray areas, protective coal bunkers. During the 1870s, the rapid increase in the size and power of armor-piercing guns caused problems for the designers of battleships and cruisers alike. Even a ship designed with adequate armor protection from the current generation of guns might be vulnerable to new guns powerful enough to penetrate its armor. Consequently, naval designers tried a novel method of armoring their ships. The vital parts, engines, boilers, magazines, and enough hull structure to keep the ship stable in the event of damage, could be positioned underneath an armored deck just below the waterline. This deck, which would only be struck very obliquely by shells, could be thinner and lighter than belt armor. The sides of the ship would be entirely unarmored but would be as effective as an armored belt, which would not stop shellfire. Cruisers designed along these guidelines, known as protected cruisers, superseded armored cruisers in the 1880s and early 1890s. As mentioned earlier, the armored cruiser Shannon was the first ship to make use of an armored deck. However, by the end of the 1870s, ships could be found with full-length armored decks and little or no side armor. The Italian Italia. The breakthrough for the protected cruiser design came with the Chilean Esmeralda, designed and built by the British firm Armstrong at their Elswick yard. Esmeralda, with a high speed of 18 knots, dispensed entirely with sails and carried an armament of 2 10 inches and 6 6 inches guns, considered very powerful for a ship her size. Her protection scheme, inspired by the Italia class, included a full-length protected deck up to 2 inches thick, and a cork-filled cofferdam along her sides. Esmeralda set the tone for cruiser construction for the years to come, with Elswick cruisers on a similar design being constructed for Italy, China, Japan, Argentina, Austria, and the United States. Protected cruisers became attractive for two reasons. First, the concept of the armored cruiser was not embraced wholeheartedly in naval circles. Second, several navies were caught in a race between armor thickness and the size of main guns and did not have the money to spend on battleships and armored cruisers. The use of smaller, cheaper cruisers was a better alternative. French armored cruiser Depuis de Lomé. The French Navy adopted the protected cruiser wholeheartedly in the 1880s. The Jeune École school of thought, which proposed a navy composed of fast cruisers for commerce raiding and torpedo boats for coast defense, was particularly influential in France. The first French protected cruiser was the SFAX, laid down in 1882, and followed by 6 classes of protected cruiser, and no armored cruisers until the Depuis de Lomé, laid down in 1888 but not finished until 1895. Depuis de Lomé was a revolutionary ship, being the first French armored cruiser to dispose entirely of masts, and sheathed in steel armor. However, she and 2 other were not sufficiently seaworthy, and their armor could be penetrated by modern quick-firing guns. Thus from 1891-7 the French reverted to the construction of protected cruisers. The British Royal Navy was equivocal about which protection scheme to use until 1887. The large Imperieuse fast ships like the 14,000-ton powerful development was the publication in 1890 of American naval strategist Alfred Thayer Mahan's book The Influence of Sea Power Upon History. While Mahan emphasized the importance of battleships above all other types of warships in obtaining command of the sea, armored cruisers and large protected cruisers could still be used as second-class battleships to maintain control of the sea lanes and potentially as fighting units of a battle fleet. The armored cruisers built in the mid to late 1890s were often as large and expensive as pre-dreadnought battleships. They combined long range, high speed, and an armament approaching that of battleship with enough armor to protect them against quick firing guns, considered the most important weapons afloat at the time. Their speed was made possible due to another development, case hardened steel armor, first Harvey armor and then crucially Krupp armor. The higher tensile strength of these armors compared to nickel steel and mild steel made it feasible to put a light yet useful armor belt on a large cruiser. They saved further weight by not requiring a heavy timber backing, as previous armor plating had, to soften and spread the force of the impact from oncoming shells, 25 inches 64. The conning tower. With these improvements, the ships became more fully protected than was possible previously. They were also expensive to maintain at fighting strength, as they required a greater number of stokers to feed the boilers than a battleship when steaming at flank speed. Edgar Quinet in 1911. The ideas presented by Mahan prompted French Admiral Ernest François Fournier to write his book La Flotte Nécessaire in 1896. Fournier argued that a fleet of technologically advanced armored cruisers and torpedo craft would be powerful and flexible enough to engage in a wide range of activity and overwhelm potential enemies. French naval and government circles embraced this ideal mutually, and even advocates of battleships over cruisers admitted the latter's potential usefulness in scouting and commercial warfare. The result was the building of increasingly large armored cruisers. The Jeanne d'Arc, laid down in 1896, displaced 11,000 tons, carried a mixed armament of 76-inch 193. Turrets. The Edgar Quinettes, slightly faster at 23 knots, were armed with 14,774-inch 194. Vessels from France and Britain began an armored cruiser program of its own with the end of the First Sino-Japanese War in 1895 and the return under pressure from Russia in what became known as the Triple Intervention of the Liaodong Peninsula to China. Japan began a 10-year naval build-up program under the slogan Perseverance and Determination, Wo Shin Chong Dan Gishinshoten, in preparation for further confrontations. The core of this 109-ship build-up was the 6-6 program of 6 battleships and 6 eventually 8 armored cruisers comparable to the British Cressy class. The Yakumo followed the basic pattern for these cruisers, on a 9,646 long tons 9,801 guns on broadside, she carried between 7 and 12. Brooklyn was an improved version of the New York and Olympia designs, more heavily armed with 8-8-inch 203. Growth among all the major naval powers, according to naval historian Eric Osborne, as they showcased the abilities of the modern ships in warfare. The only time cruisers were seen in any of their traditional role, he continues, was as blockade ships during the Spanish-American War. More often, they were seen fighting in a battle line. They would not have been seen in their designed role until World War I. Even with all their improvements and apparent performance, opinion on the armored cruiser was mixed. The 1904 edition of the Encyclopedia Americana quotes an otherwise unidentified Captain Walker, USN, in describing the role of the armored cruiser as that of a vessel possessing in a high degree offensive and defensive qualities, with the capacity of delivering her attack at points far distant from her base in the least space of time. The same source defines an armored cruiser as a battleship in which the qualities of offense and defense have been much reduced to gain high speed and great coal capacity, and adds, there are many who hold that the armored cruiser is an anomaly, something less than a battleship and more than a protected cruiser, performing satisfactorily the duties of neither, with no special function of her own and lacking the great desideratum in warships, ability to fight in proportion to her great size and cost. 1900s, Battle of Tsushima and the battlecruiser Nishin 1905. Armored cruisers were used with success in the line of battle by the Japanese at the Battle of Tsushima in 1905. Of the battle damage received by the Japanese, the armored cruiser Nishin received 8 hits, which destroyed 3 of her 8-inch 203. The armored cruiser has reached a point which renders its participation in future fleet actions almost a certainty, and called for a battleship cruiser which would possess the speed of a cruiser and the firepower of a capital ship. Other naval authorities remained skeptical. Mayen called the interest in armored cruisers a fad, then explained, she is armored, and she is a cruiser, and what have you got a ship to lie in the line, as our ancestors used to say. No, and yes, that is to say, she may at a pinch, and at a risk that exceeds her powers, a cruiser. Yes, and no, for order to give her armor and armament which do not fit the line, you have given tonnage beyond what is needed for the speed and coal endurance proper for a cruiser. By giving this tonnage to armor and armament, you have taken it from other uses, either from increasing her own speed and endurance, or from providing another cruiser. You have in her more cruiser than she ought to have, and less armored vessel, or less cruiser and more armored ship. I do not call this a combination, though I do call it a compromise. I do not say you have a useless ship. I do say that you have not as useful a ship as, for the tonnage, you ought to have Japanese armored cruiser Tsukuba. Buoyed with their success at Tsushima, Japan laid down the 4 Tsukuba-class cruisers between 1905 and 1908 at a speed of 205 knots. They carried an extremely heavy main armament of 4 12-inch 305.76. Bismarck and SMS was planned as an armored cruiser in part because the British had misled the Germans on the Invincibles then being constructed. The Germans expected these new British ships to be armed with 6 or 8 92. Fast, heavily armed scout, commerce protector and cruiser destroyer, reflected in the term originally ascribed to them, large armored cruiser. However, they were much larger, faster and better armed than armored cruisers, able to outpace them, stay out of range of their weapons and destroy them with relative impunity because they carried the heavy guns normally ascribed to battleships. They could also theoretically hold their place in a battle line more readily than armored cruisers and serve as the battleship cruiser for which Hovgaard had argued after Tsushima. All these factors made battle cruisers attractive fighting units. Although Britain, Germany and Japan would be the only powers to build them, they also meant that the armored cruiser as it had been known was now outmoded and no more were built after 1910. The United States Naval Institute put the matter bluntly in its 1908 written proceedings: "It is very doubtful if an armored cruiser of the Colorado class would dare even tackle a Monitor, for fear that one of the latter's shot might hit a vital spot, and if it did she would lose her only raison d'etre, for a crippled cruiser would be useless as a cruiser, and still not fit to lie in the line." It may be urged that an armored cruiser was never intended to fight a battleship, then what is she intended for? Surely not as a scout or a commerce destroyer. For vessels a fifth the displacement could do this work as well, and numbers are required here, not strength. If she is to overtake a weaker enemy, you must first assume a smaller enemy, otherwise she could not have superiority in both speed and strength by escaping from a stronger enemy. She will never win wars. Later in the same address as this, every argument used against holds true for battle cruisers of the invincible type, except that the latter, if wounded, would be fit to lie in the line, owing to her great armament. If it is hoped to fight at such great ranges that her 7-inch belt and 5-inch side will be of value, then the armor of battleships is wrong, not in principle, but in distribution. World War I. Although pre-dreadnought battleships and armored cruisers were outclassed by modern battleship and battlecruiser designs, respectively, armored cruisers still played an active role in World War I. Their armor and firepower was sufficient to defeat other cruiser types and armed merchant vessels, while their speed and range made them particularly useful for extended operations out in the high seas. Some German and Royal Navy vessels, like the HMS Station with newer ships, superior gunnery and optimal logistics, the Germans sank the Royal Navy armored cruisers HMS Allies battlecruisers, especially the Imperial Japanese Navy and the Royal Australian Navy. In fact, he described the latter's flagship, the battlecruiser Australia, as being superior to his entire force by itself at the Falklands. He had already deduced the battle was lost when he missed the chance to attack the British battlecruisers in port during the Battle of Dogger Bank. The SMS possessed by the navies of the great powers, a capital ship was defined as any vessel of over 10,000 tons displacement or with guns over 8 in caliber, and several more armored cruisers were decommissioned to comply with the terms of the treaty. The London Naval Treaty of 1930 introduced further limits on cruiser tonnage. Only a small number of armored cruisers survived these limitations, though a handful saw action in World War II. The armored cruiser enjoyed a brief and limited resurgence in the late 1920s and early 1930s. Albeit for mainly political reasons, with the three Panzerschiff literally armored ships that Germany built, the Deutschland, Admiral Scheer, and Admiral Graf Spee. The German Navy, renamed the Reichsmarine after the end of World War I, chose the name for this class with great care. Although in French the term effectively described a battleship, in German the term referred to the armored cruiser, which had been considered a class below capital ships. The impression the Reichsmarine attempted to give by using it was that it was developing a modest vessel in line with the Treaty of Versailles. According to this treaty, which Germany signed at the end of World War I, the Reichsmarine could replace the 6 pre-dreadnoughts it had been left as capital ships when they were 20 years old. New vessels were to displace at most 10,000 long tons, 10,000 coastal defense ships similar to those operated by the Scandinavian navies could be built instead. Germany built a trio of ships fast enough to evade most enemy capital ships, armed with larger main guns than permitted for cruisers built under the Washington and London naval treaties, though they were stated to displace 10,000 long tons, 10,000 links, but its sources remain unclear because it lacks inline citations. Please help to improve this section by introducing more precise citations. May 2012. Learn how and when to remove this template message. The armored cruiser was not a close ancestor of heavy cruisers, even though the name sometimes suggests this. By 1905 the armored cruiser had grown in size and power to be very close to the pre-dreadnought battleships of the day, with a displacement of around 15,000 tons, considerably larger than the 10,000 tons of the heavy cruiser. This trend resulted in the battlecruiser, which was initially conceived as an armored cruiser on the same scale as the dreadnought battleship. By 1915, both battleships and battlecruisers had grown markedly. HMS Steam engines of their era, like their protected cruiser predecessors and contemporary light cruisers, heavy cruisers lacked a side armored belt, saving weight to achieve high speeds. The main armament of a heavy cruiser at a maximum 203. Baxter, P197, Osborne, PP28-9, 31-2, Sandler, P53. Baxter, P202-3, Fairburn, PP351-9, Osborne, PP32-3, Sandler, P53. Baxter, PP314-15, Parkinson, P150, Roberts, P89. Sandler, PP54-5. Parks, P235. Beeler, P183, Osborne, P32-3. Osborne, P33-4, Parks, P239. Osborne, P28. Parkinson, P151, Sandhaus, P117. Beeler, PP42-4, Parkinson, P149. Osborne, P41, Roberts, P107. Roberts, P128. Parks, PP309-12. Osborne, PP41-2, Parkinson, P151. Roberts, P109. Friedman, Cruisers, P16, Osborne, P61, Tucker. Carrot Brown, P152, Lambert, PP22-3, Osborne, P61, Roberts, P128. Roberts, P128, Rop et al., 296-7. Carrot Brown, P157-58, Lambert, PP20-22, Osborne, 61-62. Carrot Conroys, PP. Carrot Conway's, P24, Lambert, PP107, 114-16. Carrot Hovgaard, Transactions, PP111, 115-16. Carrot Mayen, 390-1. Carrot Burr, PP22, 24, Friedman, Cruisers, Osborne, P73. Carrot Brown, PP158, 162, Conway's, P142, Osborne, PP62, 74. Carrot Tucker. Carrot Massey, Castles, PP614-15, 647. Carrot Bittlingmeyer, P73, Preston, P117, Williamson, PP3-4. Carrot Breyer, PP286-8, Gardner. Press ISBN. Friedman, Norman, 1985. U.S. Battleships, an Illustrated History. Naval Institute Press ISBN. Massey, Robert K. 2003. Castles of Steel, Britain, Germany, and the Winning of the Great War at Sea. Random House ISBN